Good morning, everyone. My name is Roy Widrick from New York Sea Grant, and I will be moderating today's webinar. Sam Schultz will be assisting with any technical issues should they arise. Welcome, and thank you for joining the 2019 Watercraft Inspection Webinar Series. Before we get started, I have a couple of housekeeping items to cover. If you have participated in other webinars, you're likely to have heard this before, but I want to make sure to reiterate for those who have not. The recording for today's webinar will be available on the New York Invasive Species Clearinghouse website and the New York Sea Grant website and YouTube channel in the coming weeks. Now, this is an important part. Towards the end of this presentation, we will share a link for an evaluation with you in the chat box. It takes on average a couple of 2 minutes, and your responses will help shape future programs. Again, this is pretty important. Currently, I have the audio settings for attendees on mute to avoid background noises that may be a distraction from today's presentation. I highly recommend that you submit questions through the webinar by typing them into the chat box. You can now open this by clicking on the little chat toggle at the bottom of the webinar window. The chat window should then appear on the right-hand side of your screen. We will address questions in the order they were received during the Q&A session at the end of today's presentation. Please be sure to select who you'd like to send your chat to the host, or to anyone else. Now on to our presentation, assessing the risk of future aquatic invasive species establishment in a changing world. I am pleased to introduce you to our presenter, Sarah Stallman. Sarah Stallman is Extension Leader with Pennsylvania Sea Grant. She started in 2006 and became Extension Leader in July 2017. Sarah is responsible for providing statewide leadership and management for the Pennsylvania Sea Grant Extension Program in several key areas, including water quality, climate change, fisheries, invasive species and waterway, and land use planning. Throughout her career, Sarah has engaged with local, national, and international audiences by providing presentations, organizing stakeholder workshops, and developing successful products and programs. She earned her bachelor's in biology with a minor from psychology from Penn State Barron, her master's degree in biology from Shippensburg University of Pennsylvania. And with that, I will pass the presentation on to you, Sarah.
All right, thanks, Roy. All right, let me see if I can share my screen here. Okay, are you guys seeing the right view here?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. All right, good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me today. Hope everybody's staying warm. My presentation today is going to talk about some of the challenges we may face moving forward as climate continues to change, and then what effect that may have on invasive species. And also talk about a process that we're using in Pennsylvania to identify some of the species we may want to keep an eye out for moving forward. So in this presentation, I'm looking at two very important stressors. Aquatic invasive species, which we all know are considered one of the biggest threats to species biodiversity, food security, and livelihoods, and then climate change, which has the potential to impact the distribution, spread, abundance, and impact of the species that we're trying to manage. So let's look at how these two stressors might work synergistically, and then how that will affect our management of aquatic invasive species. So first we need to think about what kinds of changes and impacts we're expecting to see into the future. So in Pennsylvania over the next century, and in most other places, including New York, the climate is overall getting warmer. So data shows that we've experienced rapid warming in the past few decades, and the last decade has actually been the warmest on record. In the last century, we've warmed more than half a degree Fahrenheit, and the projections have us continuing to rise and experience even more heat. So things have the potential to get really hot. This graphic is showing the number of days per year over 90 degrees in Pennsylvania, with blue being 10 or fewer days, and red reaching up to 120 days per year over 90 degrees. So you can see in that late century scenario, there's quite a few red spots. And then this is the projection information for New York, showing on average from 1971 to 2000, the average was about 18 days per year. And it's projected to increase as high as 87 days per year in the later part of the century. So now looking at changes in precipitation, overall, there's been a 5 to 10% increase of average annual precipitation in the last century. But this map is focusing on very heavy precipitation events and is showing the percent change in intensity of precipitation from 1958 to 2007. So if you look at the Northeast region, including Pennsylvania and New York, that's been the most pronounced increase in these heavy downpour events, with almost a 70% increase. Looking into the next century, annual precipitation, as well as frequency of intense rain and storm events, are likely to continue to rise, although we're expecting to see these changes occur more seasonally, meaning that we're going to see more precipitation in the winter and spring, and then less during the summer and fall. We're also expected to see increases in other extreme climatic events, along with heavy rain and storm events. Things like extreme heat, severe flooding, drought, snow, ice, and windstorms. And these events are expected to, and already have, been changing in frequency, magnitude, and duration. So the big question then becomes, how might all of the changes we just talked about impact the invasion of species? We know that invasive species will probably respond to climate changes differently than native species. A lot of this is just due to their general characteristics. So things like having broad climatic tolerances, large geographic ranges, and their responses to climate change will likely have significant implications, both ecologically and economically. So changes in temperature and precipitation may alter transport and introduction mechanisms. So basically that means species will have more ways to get here and have a better chance of surviving once they are here. So for example, floodwaters can provide opportunities for species to escape confinement or other barriers and then be carried to a new location. Heavy wind events can transport things like bacteria and fungi. Heat waves and drought can decrease biotic resistance of a system by putting that persistent stress and disturbance and eventually causing mortality events or the complete shifting out of resident species. And then that opens up opportunities and resources for invasives to then come in. So we're gonna see the introduction of new species through new pathways, but we're also going to see altered distributions of existing invasive species. So warming temperatures are likely to facilitate spread since many invasive species have range limitations that are set by extreme cold or ice cover. So as things warm and those barriers start to diminish, species will then be able to expand the range to areas where they previously could not survive. And because of their many dispersal traits, existing invasive species will most likely expand their ranges more quickly than native species will. There's also going to be altered impact of existing invasive species. So some species might see exacerbated impacts while others may see diminished impacts. For example, studies have found that increased CO2 levels coupled with warming temperatures can actually increase the growth rate of hydrilla, which already has a very high growth rate, growing over an inch per day. However, the invasive virus, viral hemorrhagic septicemia, may actually see diminished impacts because it typically causes mortality events in colder waters. So warming could possibly diminish the number of mortality events that we're seeing from the species. And then last, we might need to start rethinking about the kinds of control strategies we're using to control species under these different climate scenarios. So for example, where areas where hand-pulling for species like water hyacinth and water chestnut were once maybe sufficient, that might no longer be the case. And they may need more aggressive, sustained, and probably expensive methods. We also may need to increase our use of chemical controls, which then brings up questions about climate impacts to the fate and behavior of the pesticides that we're using. And then the effectiveness of current biocontrol agents and the species they are targeted to control are probably going to need reevaluated. So ultimately, we're going to need a lot more monitoring. So we're looking at a really big issue here with many different components, which will all have implications for aquatic invasive species management. So our future AIS management will need to adapt, especially since issues with AIS are immediate, well, climate change is more subtle and long-term. So oftentimes our resource managers have a difficult time knowing when they should address it. So we're gonna need to start relying on new tools and strategies that focus on research that integrates both climate change and invasive species. So I pulled out two key questions to consider here. One being, how will specific invasive species behave under an altered climate? And then which new species may emerge as invasive? And I have the second one here highlighted in red as my project focuses a lot more on this particular question. So my work actually pulls from three existing studies. One was previous work I did for my graduate thesis research doing climate matching, but this was using an Australian-based software called ClimeMatch. It had the same basic principles. So this study is kind of like a validation study of that work, but using updated software and a program that's a lot more US-centric and not focused on Australia. The second is work being done by Jason Granberg in Wisconsin, who is also using the same tool. It's the RAMP tool, which I'll talk about in a little bit, to forecast invasive species spread and establishment using the climate matching process. So I did pull some of his methodology as well. And then last, Faulkner's methodology for developing invasive species watch lists. So essentially, I'm asking the question at a very high level, what species should be considered high risk for future invasion into Pennsylvania under various climate scenarios? So why climate matching? Ultimately, I chose climate matching as the main risk assessment strategy here because climate is a main basic filter. We know that even if all other environmental conditions and resources are right, if the climate is too cold or it's too warm for that species tolerances, then a species won't be able to survive and persist there. In addition, looking at work done by Notre Dame and Loyola University and a lot of others that are doing risk work on risk assessments, they actually found that climate match came up as a main predictor that is used for fish, plants, and mollusks when looking at traits that allow the transition from being introduced to becoming established. So for fish, it's actually the best predictor for whether a species will become established. For plants, that climate match is coupled with information on life history, invasion history, and ecology. And then for mollusks, climate match is coupled with information on reproductive output. Okay, so diving a little bit more into the process end of things, the first step in this study was to obtain a list of potential species that may pose a threat to Pennsylvania in the future. So for example, species that are not currently in Pennsylvania, but that are south of Pennsylvania and have the potential to move northward as the climate warms. So in my previous work, I had already developed a really large list of species by going through the USGS Non-Indigenous Aquatic Species Database and choosing species that, again, weren't currently present in Pennsylvania, but there were a few other filters, like we didn't use hybrids, we didn't use intentionally stocked species, etc. So for this go around, I added to the list a little bit by looking at species in the Global Invasive Species Database, species that are found in analog states. And analog states are essentially states that will have a future climate similar to Pennsylvania, which is determined by looking at downscaled climate projection models. And then also high-risk species that are listed in the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service ecological risk screening summaries. So for this study, I overall ended up with 118 species to look at. So here's a little overview of the RAMP program. Again, this program was developed by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and it does run in ArcGIS, so basic knowledge of GIS is necessary to run the program, versus ClimeMatch, which I used in my first study. That was more of a browser-based program that anyone could access, just get on the web, put in the address, and access it and use it. RAMP and ClimeMatch both run using the same 16 climate variables. And those are, there's 8 temperature and 8 precipitation variables. So looking at things like average mean temperature, maximum, minimum temperatures of the warmest and coldest months, et cetera, things like that. And then they also run using the same Euclidean algorithm to run the programs. There's a couple main differences though. So ClimeMatch actually did not have predictive capacity to look into the future. So that had to be done by a lot of tedious work with downscaled climate projection models. And the difference here is that RAMP actually has that built in. So it has the ability to run under those different scenarios right into the program, which is great. So here you're seeing the different current and future climate scenarios that it uses, both a midterm 2050 and a longer range 2070 scenario, and then three different representative concentration pathways, or RCPs. And this represents greenhouse gas emission scenarios that are relative to time frame. So for example, if you're looking at RCP 4.5, that would assume that global greenhouse gas emissions would peak around 2040 and then decline, whereas if you're looking at an RCP of 8.5, emissions would continue to rise into the 21st century. So another plus to using RAMP over ClimatCH is just the number of weather data points that are available for the United States. So in ClimatCH, there was not even 2,000 US weather points, whereas using RAMP, the risk assessment mapping tool, there's almost 43,000 points. So it gives it a lot more finer scale view of things. And then within the RAMP program, essentially to run this, a dialog box is used to just enter the scientific name of the species of interest. And then the program will automatically create a species profile folder for that species by obtaining species record information pulled from GBIF and pulling that information into a file. So based on the data that is pulled from GBIF, the program then creates a pre-selection of a species current range. So this is showing an example of a pre-selection for the Mozambique tilapia, showing different occurrence records that are housed within that database. But you have to look a little bit closer here. The good news is RAMP allows you to go in and either add or remove weather stations based on additional knowledge or additional occurrence data that you might have for that species. So probably the most important and time-consuming part of this process is to actually go in and identify any outliers you might see or any unverified records. So for example, using USGS, non-indigenous aquatic species database to cross-reference the information shown here for the Mozambique tilapia, several of the US points that showed up in GBIF, I actually ended up removing. Either they didn't show up in USGS at all to verify the occurrence, or in this case, there's actually a few points, such as those that were found in Idaho, where the record of the species being found was actually in thermal pools. So that was not an accurate representation of that species' actual climate tolerance. So this was probably the most difficult step, is having to go through and verify occurrence records for every single one of the species. And there's quite a few occurrence records on some of them. But once you get there and you are satisfied with the occurrence data that you have in the pre-selection, you can then move on to step three, which is actually going ahead and performing the climate match. So you have your choice of region. You can look globally, you can look at just the continental US, or you can look state by state. And you just enter the scientific name of the species of interest, and then you choose your climate scenario. So for this project, I'm running all of these climate scenarios from current climate on to compare the species suitability depending on the different greenhouse gas concentrations and timeframes. So here's an example of the process run all the way through with a species, the vermiculated sailfin catfish. If you look on the screen, you can see the occurrence data that I settled on for the species before running the match. And you can see your current range of South America, Mexico, and parts of the southern United States. So we ran the match for our current climate scenario, and here you can see the results for the vermiculated sailfin catfish for the entire United States, and then a closer up look at climate match just for Pennsylvania. So when you're looking at the output, it's basically a color-coded numerical scale. So it runs from 0 to 10, with 0 or blue being your lowest possible match, and 10 in red being your highest possible match. So MATCH is designated based on the species Climate 6 score. So a Climate 6 score is basically the sum of all climate scores that are greater than 6 and then divided by the total number of climate scores. So for this example, there are a total of 491 data points that were used in Pennsylvania, and then 29 points with a score of 6. Excuse me. So there was none higher. So there were 29 points with a score of 6, nothing else higher. So 29 divided by the 491 gives us a Climate 6 score of 0.059. So now you go up and look at the chart for the climate match category, and you can see that that climate match score of 0.059 falls in the medium risk category. So let's do this again, and now we can compare our current baseline results with a future scenario. So here we're looking at the same output for the vermiculated sailfin catfish, but we're looking at the RCP of 8.5 in 2070. So again, we have to calculate our Climate 6 score and see we have 384 sixes and 2 sevens. That gives us a total of 386 scores that are above that 6 threshold. We divide that by that same 491 points that are totaled for Pennsylvania, and then that gives us a climate score of 0.786. We have now moved into the high-risk category for this species. So essentially, this process is repeated for each of the 118 species identified for the project to help us find those species that are moving from the low and medium-risk ranges into the high-risk zone. So I'm actually still working on this project. It's taking quite a bit longer, I think, than I anticipated. So I've only at this point managed to complete the fish species at this time. So this graph is showing the current average ramp score across all the species that were run through the ramp analysis. Those species with scores above 6 are depicted by the red line. Those are the species that are currently in this current climate compatible with our climate. Now we can compare those current scores with those of a future scenario. So here we see the same species responses to that future scenario of RCP 8.5 in 2070, which is shown in the green line. So you can see here quite a bit of variability in the species that have both increased and decreased in suitability based on future climate impacts. You can also see species that have gone ahead and crossed the boundary from being previously unsuitable for our current climate and becoming suitable in this scenario. All right, so let's take a look at fish risk and the percent change in risk based on climate. So we have 16 species of fish that were considered low risk from the start, and they remained low risk through each of the climate scenarios. 32 species were considered high risk already and remained that way in each scenario. 7 increased in risk and 2 decreased in risk. So overall, 84% of species experienced no change at all based on climate scenarios, 12% experienced an increase in risk, and 2% decreased in risk. So here's a snapshot of some of our high-risk fish species. This isn't a comprehensive list yet, but just an example of some of the species that we're looking at. I included some examples of high-risk species that didn't have a change in risk level and some that had increases in risk. So we see here the vermiculated sailfin catfish again, the least killifish, the rough shiner, butterfly peacock bass all had increases in their Climate 6 scores. So let's take a little bit closer look at one of the species that is currently not considered a threat, that has a Climate 6 score of 0, but becomes a threat by mid-century, and then increases up to 84% suitability in climate by the end of the century. So this is the butterfly peacock bass. It's actually native to very restricted areas in South America. It's expanded its range in South America and has had significant impact. It's also been intentionally stocked in the United States as a sport fish, and also in some cases as a biological control agent by some state agencies in Florida, where it is established. And then it's also been introduced to areas in Hawaii and Guam and Puerto Rico. So in areas where it has been introduced, it has had a significant impact on populations of native fish. And some studies have reported as much as a 25% decline in forage fish from the species. So again, this is the current ramp output for the butterfly peacock bass. So you can see that in our numerical scoring on the side, none of the data points scored above a 6, so our current climate score for the species is 0. Let's fast forward to 2070. Again, RCP 8.5. We're now looking at a climate 6 score of that 0.84. And again, just to go over it one more time to calculate it, we took the sum of the number of scores above 6. So there were 256 sixes and 157 sevens, which totals 413 out of the 491 gives the climate score of 0.84. I also took the liberty to run this through for New York to compare results. And again, we see in current scenario, New York is not climatically suitable for the species with a climate score of 0. And then that score increases to 0.507 in 2070. So again, this study is meant to look at things in more of a big picture sense. There's many different limitations to doing a study like this. First is that distribution changes of invasive species are very difficult to relate to climate because not all species that we're looking at may have had time to spread to their climatic limits. So there's definitely issues with accuracy concerning distributions that are used in the analysis. So it may not be completely accurate as you're not getting a full complete picture of that species climatic tolerance based on distribution. Second, the rate at which a species spreads depends on many different system and species specific factors that go beyond climate matching, which makes it difficult to form broad generalizations. So this work should be viewed as a first pass at narrowing down an extremely large list of species to then give a more manageable number of species to look at more in depth. And for my last study, I did take that second step. There was a couple species that came out very high risk, and then going forward to look at other things like propagule pressure, impact in other areas, using invasive scoring kits to get a more comprehensive picture of what that species would look like. And then last, I mentioned previously that the RAMP scores are pulled from GBIF. They're very difficult to quality control. It's very time consuming and it can also be very subjective. So one person may have chosen to include a record that another person may not choose to include. And that one record can have a significant impact on what the output is. So depending on whether you choose to include a record or not, that can make a big difference. So my hopes for work like this is to help our natural resource managers start to think more proactively rather than reactively about aquatic invasive species and provide some insight on which species we may want to consider looking at in the future. So currently, Pennsylvania's Aquatic Invasive Species Management Plan does not include climate change considerations at all. So as I finish running the analysis on the additional species, and then again, I'd like to go in and provide those more in-depth analyses on the species that come out as high risk. We'd then like to pull together a list of Pennsylvania's future riskiest species and provide some considerations for future work. Also, kind of as shown in the peacock bass example, many, if not most, of the species run through this analysis would probably have similar results for New York, making this work and the results applicable to other areas that have similar climates. So I realize I actually went through that really fast, but that is all I have. So I am happy to take any questions there might be.
Okay, thanks, Sarah. We're now going to begin the Q&A session. As a reminder, just use the chat box on the bottom right-hand side of the screen, and we'll pick the questions as soon as they start popping up. There's got to be some questions out there.
I must have done a good job at explaining.
Yeah, well, it was pretty thorough. Okay, this is from Lucas. The last slide had what looked to be a picture of a piranha. Are they a future species?
Okay, so I included the piranha in here because that was actually a species that came out as high risk in my previous study. Three of the species shown here came out as high risk. The funny thing is, for this go around, it did come out as a medium risk, but did not score as high as it had in the previous study. So it's kind of interesting to see comparing the results from the climate program with the RAMP program. But yes, that is a species that will need to be looked at in the future.
Okay, from Olivia, is RAMP, just moved on me. Is RAMP applicable in other countries with the example of Canada?
Yes. So you can choose Canada as the input or the output. So if you want to compare a species and only get the results for Canada, that is an option you can choose.
Okay. Is there one fish species that you see as poses the greatest short-term risk? And I would assume that's for either Pennsylvania or New York.
So I'm going to go back to, this is the list of high-risk fish that I ended up with. And so, I mean, if you're looking just for high risk as in numbers, like the least killifish, 94% climate suitability. It was already a medium risk, went to high risk. Species like brush shiner increased from low risk to high risk. So kind of looking at those species that start out at, you know, low or medium and end up as high risk with a high percentage for suitability are going to be the species you want to focus on. But the interesting thing is seeing species like blue tilapia, red-bellied tilapia, Nile tilapia, Amazon sailfin, those that are already at risk that we don't have, that, you know, maybe we need to start thinking about immediately because you know, their suitability is already, you know, there. And their risk just continues to get higher into the future.
Sarah?
Yes.
You're echoing. You maybe sit closer to your mic.
Yeah, I don't know why it's all of a sudden, whoops, echoing. I didn't change anything. My face is right in my computer. I'm not sure what to do about it.
Okay.
Any other questions? There we go. From Doug Jensen, based on the species identified as high risk to Pennsylvania, can those be assigned to primary pathways? Do you see this tool to be used to improve pathway management regionally?
I definitely hope so. I will be honest in that, you know, right before this presentation is when I just completed my very last run through. So the actual opportunity to go through and do more of that in-depth analysis, which would include looking at vectors of spread and pathways, hasn't happened yet. But that's definitely going to be something that does happen, is to have, you know, that pathway analysis and looking at risk via those pathways and including that in that, you know, list of Pennsylvania's top risky species.
Okay, you said that climate prediction works best for fish, not so much for plants or mollusks. Did you run it for plants? And I believe you mentioned that you just started with the fish and you haven't been to the plants yet, right?
Yeah, so the studies on risk assessments show that fish had the highest, it worked the best with fish, but it also does work with plants and mollusks, just coupled with other traits that you could look at as well. Some of them were just life history traits, others were reproductive output. So yes, it can be used and it will be used. I just haven't gotten there yet because I think when I started this study, I didn't quite realize the time commitment with having to go through and verify all of those points involved. But once you get past that point and you already have kind of that initial distribution zone identified, then it can be a lot quicker to run this. But yes, the short answer is yes, I will be doing this for plants. I will also be doing it for mollusks.
Okay. Can RAMP be used for terrestrial systems?
As far as I know, RAMP can be used with any species that has a profile that's attached to it in GBIF. And if I hope I'm not mistaken in saying this, I know you can actually upload your own data sets. So as long as you have a data set with you know, climate information, distribution information for a species, you should be able to upload it into the program and use it.
Okay, and a question from Sam Schultz is, what is peacock bass being used as a biocontrol for?
I don't know if I looked that far into it. I was just doing kind of some reading to see where the species is currently at in the United States and, you know, how it's been introduced. So it was more just reading that it's been used for biocontrol. My guess would that if it's in Florida, it may have been used for controlling introduced cichlids or other species that, yeah, I think it's cichlids, but don't quote me.
Okay. Does RAMP work for invertebrates like killer shrimp or spiny water flea?
Yes, it should. As far as I know, there's no limitations on the type of species that it should work for. As long as you have those climatic tolerances and distribution data, all it does is compare the species range, distribution range with an output. So it could work for anything. You just need to make sure that the species that you're looking at or you're interested in, that climate match is a good indicator of risk. Like I had said, with the studies that were done by Notre Dame and some other folks, they had shown that, you know, fish climate match is a good indicator. So you could use it with anything, but you'd have to just be careful and understand that it might not be the be-all end-all for determining risk on that species.
Okay. Can you apply a different observation database to use RAMP, something that is easier to verify?
Yes, you can. If you have access to it, you can upload any database into the program. Again, you have to have some basic knowledge of ArcGIS to know how to upload the data. But if you wanted to use just like a USGS database, or you can add additional database information to an existing GBIF file. So if you wanted to combine the two, you could do that as well and use it as another layer. And I should also mention that U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service does offer trainings on using RAMP if this is something that anybody's interested in kind of following suit with and using as a program. I can get you the contact information and you can request a training.
Okay. There's one. From Doug Jensen again, it would seem to me that if those species could be assigned to groups of OIT pathways, example, aquarium, live bait, or aquaculture, that would help Sea Grant to prioritize outreach in federal and state management authorities for regulating those species that are in those OIT traits.
Yes. Yep. Absolutely. One of our future hopes for pulling together all the data and pulling together those Pennsylvania future riskiest species is all the applications and ways that this information can be used. Absolutely.
Okay. Taking any last minute questions here? Okay, if that's it, then I just want to thank Sarah and everyone for attending today's webinar on assessing the risk of future aquatic invasive species establishment in a changing world. You will look at the chat box right now. Samantha Schultz just shared a very important link that will be to our Qualtrics survey that will let you know how we did with today's webinar. And by clicking on that, it only takes about 2 minutes. That really helps us out in shaping our future programming. And we would really appreciate that a lot if you guys could give up a couple minutes of your time and help us out there. On behalf of today's presenter and New York Sea Grant, thank you for joining us. We hope you found this information and dialogue valuable in supporting your work. Please tune in to our next webinar on February 7th. That will be next Thursday. That will cover dealing with the public, handling harassment, and other issues. Enjoy the rest of your day, and please join us next week.